Take my hand, lead me on, let me stand.
On August 16th, 1977, the tragic news spread that Elvis had died in his beloved home, Graceland.
Take my hand, precious love, lead me home.
Mr. Vernon, Elvis's dad, called J.D. and wanted him to come over there to Memphis and kind of help him with this thing, help him with the funeral. He trusted old J.D., you know, and they just kind of like a, J.D. was a family member, so to speak. So J.D. and myself went over there, and we sat right there in the den there in the jungle room and made out the funeral, the whole program.
I received a call from Memphis, J.D. Sumner, and also Mr. Presley, Elvis's father, and he told me that he had passed away, and I said, well, I knew that, I heard it on the radio. He said, well, what we're calling about is Mr. Presley wants you to come and preach at the funeral. And also, he wants you to tell what happened when you and your wife, Maud Amy, met with him in Las Vegas.
At the river I stand, guide my feet, hold my hand.
I remember pulling into Graceland. As we pulled into the gates and I saw those 20,000 people, my first thought was, this guy's like the president of the United States. I mean, this is big. And it just went all over me how big his death was. And so we drive up to the house, and of course everyone that is anyone was there. In fact, I saw Caroline Kennedy sitting on the steps leading up to his bedroom. She was a little girl. And Elvis's, the kitchen, they were cooking food. It was like an old Southern wake, you know.
To the light, lead me home to the light.
You come in the front door, and to the right is the living room, and to the left, it's like most of these antebellum houses, to the left is the dining room, you know. So there's not a lot of room in there, but there's a couple hundred people, you know, just crammed into these first couple rooms. And so when it came time, Rex Humbard did the eulogy, and the quartets, of course, would come and sing around the piano, and everybody else then. There were some chairs in the living room where the immediate family sat, of course. And then the hallway, or the vestibule that between the living room and the dining room, starting there and all the way into the dining room, there were just people crammed in there, you know, trying to look into the living room to see what was going on.
The ones that were there were friends or staff or close people. The public was not invited at all to that funeral. The quartets were there that he had sang with, and they'd sang with him. His manager, of course, Colonel Parker. Some of the Hollywood people that he had known was present there also. But the main thing was the spirit and the feeling that was generated when all this gospel music was sang by these various quartets as a group, not as individual quartet, but as all of them came together, their voices was tremendous. And it was something that created an atmosphere that was very, very spiritual, which made it easy when I got ready to talk.
When Joe Gershio, who was Elvis' orchestra director, learned that I was going to sing How Great Thou Art, he came to me, he said, Mr. Blackwood, said, I have directed Elvis singing How Great Thou Art hundreds of times. Would you give me the honor of letting me direct it one last time? I said, why, sure. And when I did How Great Thou Art, Mr. Gershio stood over the side, directed me with tears running down at his face. That's a scene that is indelible in my memory. I will never, never forget that moment what a touching, touching thing it was.
We'll understand it all by and by. Tempted and tried, we'll of me. Why it should be thus all the day long.
It wasn't like a particular group, like the Blackwood Brothers didn't sing, or the Statesmen, or the Imperials, or the Jordanaires, but it was a member or two from different groups put together to make a group and to sing some songs that Elvis would have wanted to hear. And I had to, you know, and I played for one of the numbers, and it was a makeup group with different members, Jake, and of course they did several songs.
Vernon wanted me to sing "Known Only to Him." That was one of his favorite gospel songs.
And after that, we had the funeral procession.
Father. Cheer up, my brother, live in the sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by.
I rode in the front car as we went down the street. Thousands and thousands of people, families, aged, young people, older people. But one thing impressed me that I'll never forget. We came up to a cross street, and at that cross street, there was a guy on a motorcycle. The sleeves is all cut out, red, big tattoos on his arms. And as we came down the street toward him, he reached up and got this great big helmet sitting on that big motorcycle. He put it over his heart. And when we came by, he put his hand up to his head and saluted. I thought, what love.
Father.
Grieving fans gathered at the front gate for a massive candlelight vigil. As a kindness to those assembled, the casket was placed in the foyer of the mansion, and mourners were allowed to file by and pay their respects. On August 18th, the normally short drive to Forest Hill Cemetery took over an hour due to the throngs gathered to mark his passing. The occasion had all the trappings of a state funeral.
There are a few things in people's memories they will never forget, like when JFK was shot, Martin Luther King was shot, when Elvis died. That would just be in a person's memory, I suppose, very vividly, forever. And that day will be in my memory forever.
I will always regret how he called me. The last show was in Indianapolis. And he called me before he left. He didn't leave the building that night. Always they say, ladies and gentlemen, Elvis has left the building. But he stayed that night, and he called me back into his dressing room, and he said, J.D., I want you to come to Memphis. I want to talk to you about something pretty important. I said, okay. I just never did have the time to get over there to talk to him, you know. I never knew what that was.
influence that these quartets had on his life and on his music, I think, were, you know, goes without saying. You can look at his career all along and see how different events and different groups influenced him along the way. And you would think that it was vice versa, but with the gospel groups, it was, he admired these guys and these songs.
One of the biggest thrills that were, you know, was ever told to Daddy after Elvis died was one day Jack Soden, the CEO of Graceland, mentioned to J.D. that there was an acetate on Elvis's personal record player up in his bedroom. At some point, they were doing an album, and Daddy asked the engineer to do a special acetate with three or four of Elvis's favorite songs. Daddy took that acetate to Elvis, and Elvis was thrilled to death because it was something that nobody else in the world would have. But it was thrilling for Daddy to know that the last thing he played on that record player was the acetate of the Stamps singing those songs. And the recording with the acetate is still there. It's been there for 20 years. And it's evidence that he loved gospel music.
He left behind such a treasury of, I think, of his soul in gospel music.
Elvis always planned to do this huge music extravaganza with all gospel music, and that was in the works. So I think this documentary or this tribute to Elvis and his love for gospel music is something that they're probably sitting on a cloud, swinging their, you know, their legs back and forth, going, look, J.D., you know, look, J.D., look, Elvis. They're finally doing what, you know, what we wanted to do all this time.
Somewhere or another, Elvis is singing today. You got J.D. singing bass. And he's got some wonderful people with him. And if we'll be good boys, and if we'll be under God's submission, then we'll get to sing back up again with him. And then we'll never lose again.
I read comic books and I was the hero of the comic book. I saw movies and I was the hero in the movie. So every dream that I ever dreamed has come true 100 times. And these gentlemen over here, you see these type of people who care, who are dedicated, you realize that it's not possible that they might be building the kingdom of heaven. It's not too far-fetched in reality. I'd like to say that I learned very early in life that without a song, the day will never end. Without a song, a man ain't got a friend. Without a song, the road will never bend. Without a song. So I'll keep singing a song. Good night.
Have made I see the stars, I hear the I power throughout the universe displayed.
When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall
then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great.